ABC News presents JFK with Peter Jennings. 20 years ago this month, John Fitzgerald Kennedy's presidency came to its tragic end in Dallas.
We interrupt this program to bring you a special bulletin from ABC Radio. 3 shots were fired at President Kennedy's motorcade today in downtown Dallas, Texas.
State and local police have sealed off the area at Hyannis Port where the Kennedys live. No one permitted to get near that area.
Ladies and gentlemen, here is a bulletin from the WQMR newsroom. The United Press says that a sniper seriously wounded President Kennedy in downtown Dallas today, perhaps fatally. Bob, do you have more?
This latest bulletin just off the Associated Press in Dallas says the president was given the last holy rites of the Roman Catholic Church today after the assassin shot him down. A Catholic priest who performed the last rites...
President Kennedy is dead, Gordon.
Ladies and gentlemen,
this is official word.
President.
We repeat. It has just been announced. Kennedy is dead.
The plane carrying Secretary Rusk and 5 other cabinet officers to Japan has turned back. Rusk immediately decided to call off the scheduled goodwill visit to Japan. The plane on which Mr. Rusk was flying also carries White House Press Secretary Pierre Salinger, Treasury Secretary Dillon.
I heard this voice come on the radio and say, Wayside, stand by. Wayside was my code name. And he repeated that about every minute for about 5-10 minutes, I forget exactly now. And finally he said, Wayside, Lancer is dead. Lancer was the code name of the president. And there has not been a day in 20 years that somebody has not talked to me about John Kennedy. Not a day, no matter where I am in the world. So it is impossible to forget about him.
This is the BBC Home Service. It is with deep regret that we announce that President Kennedy is dead.
President Kennedy is heute Abend um 20 Uhr mitteleuropäischer Zeit.
One got the news, and then I went to the city hall, and there was a crowd, people getting together, and many Berliners did what they hadn't done since many years ago, putting candles in their windows to express their feelings.
Ladies and gentlemen, AFN interrupts its regular programming to bring you this solemn interlude of music in memory of our beloved president, John F. Kennedy.
Confidence in our country. So I call upon you to join me in this election on our journey to the new frontier, recognizing that what we do here will finally determine the fate of freedom around the world.
I ask you to join us in all the tomorrows yet to come, in building America, moving America, taking this country of ours up and sending it into the 60s.
The day of his assassination was etched into the memory of every American alive at the time.
20 years after his death, the words of John F. Kennedy still linger, as do the hopes and the promise of his presidency. His assassination, after little more than 1,000 days in office, pushed the legacy of his administration into the realm of myth, shrouded our view of his tenure with a sadness at what he might have accomplished. Tonight, we're going to look at the realities of the Kennedy presidency, what he achieved, where he failed, how close he came to meeting the promises he set for himself and the nation. We'll also try to understand why his memory haunts us still.
Brought not only the end of a decade, but the close of a political era. President Dwight David Eisenhower, approaching his eighth year in office, could not run again. His world trip at the end of 1959 had the feel of a last hurrah.
To all of you, everybody, everywhere, good night.
The Eisenhower year seemed contented and complacent. 2 days into the new decade, a new candidate burst into the political fray. He was young, and he promised dramatic change.
This is a race between the comfortable, the contented, and those who are concerned and wish to move forward. If you share my view that it's time the United States started moving again, then I ask your help.
Kennedy pledged dynamic new leadership. By a new generation, in a new decade.
I want to be known as the president at the end of 4 years, as one who not only held back the communist side, but who also advanced the cause of freedom and rebuilt American prestige.
It was a campaign of extraordinary expectation and hope. Kennedy kindled something in people. He had come of age at a time of worldwide American superiority. But his audience shared the fear that those days were numbered. This young man of great wealth and self-assurance showed Olympian reach, and they wanted to elect him, to join him. But the questions were, could America possibly achieve all he promised? Did Kennedy truly possess the character, the commitment to mobilize the country into fulfillment of his extravagant vision?
The glamour of that period, the excitement of the period, the sense of stir, bustle, movement, momentum, all that has a life of its own.
The excitement of the campaign grew as it went along. But to fulfill his own promise, Kennedy would have to become the youngest elected president, the first Catholic president. In his favor, energy, vibrance, and ability to grow and to inspire intense loyalty.
Many of us admire wit and intelligence, and he had both. And many of us admire a combination of a soft heart and a hard head. And I think he had that.
During the 11 years that I knew him, his principles evolved and developed. He continued to grow, to learn, and to deepen.
The campaign also demonstrated Kennedy's shrewd, fierce sense of competition, characteristic of his presidency.
Excuses, but I believe not in an America that is first but, first if, first when, but first period.
Kennedy brought to his campaign not only excitement but eloquence, high-minded ideals, pledges of moral leadership.
I think of the office of the presidency in the same way that Franklin Roosevelt thought of it and Woodrow Wilson. They felt the chief task of the president was to set before the American people the things that they must do.
Kennedy showed no discomfort in blending high moral aspirations with tough politics. He would do what it took to win. The West Virginia primary was the first crucial test of the nagging Catholic issue, and Kennedy forces pulled out all the stops.
The tactics that we used were tactics that were unscrupulous, unsavory, and thoroughly indigenous to West Virginia politics. Kennedy did what had to be done. After all, it's not really the way it's supposed to be in high school civics textbooks.
Primary victories beat back the Catholic issue. Kennedy came into the Los Angeles convention the front runner.
Mr. Chairman, Wyoming's vote
will make a majority for Senator Kennedy.
He got the nomination on the first ballot. Lyndon Johnson was the chosen running mate, a deft political move that would help draw conservative and southern votes in the battle ahead. After the Los Angeles convention, with the Democratic Party now united behind him, Kennedy traveled the country in a campaign that rapidly gathered momentum. To a charmed press, Kennedy was a new and sparkling breed of candidate. Kennedy's high rhetoric promised renewed strength for the country. Taking on communism anywhere in the world.
Yes, sir.
Honing a forceful America whose power in the world would be virtually limitless. Led by a fast-moving, vitally active generation.
I want the people of the world and Mr. Khrushchev to know that a new generation of Americans has taken leadership of this country, and that this free society speaks with power, force, and decision.
The focus of his campaign, like the focus of his presidency, was the worldwide competition with the Soviet Union.
We must have peace. We must.
He charged his opponent, Vice President Richard Nixon, was part of an old and failed generation who lagged behind the Soviets. Behind in space, behind in nuclear missiles.
The first vehicle in space was called Sputnik. Not Vanguard. The first passengers to return safely from outer space were named Strelka and Belka, not Rover or Fido or even Checkers.
I am getting sick and tired of hearing this constant whippering and yammering. They say our military strength is being frittered away. We're second in space. We find the communist world looking more dynamic than the American world.
Kennedy promised not only sweeping strides in foreign affairs, but a bold new domestic program as well. He would revitalize the economy, move the country forward on civil rights.
In the next 4 years, we can write into the program of this country a program of human rights.
But behind the striking rhetoric and ambitious promises stood a man given to caution and pragmatic politics. Qualities which would also define his presidency.
I would say he was bold in his conceptions, but careful in his actions. He had some striking ideas which he would propose, but he did not like fights that he wasn't going to win.
As the close campaign intensified, Kennedy went face to face with Richard Nixon in a series of debates, the first ever nationally televised. Kennedy had found the perfect medium to project his image and his promise.
And I don't want historians 10 years from now to say these were the years when the tide ran out for the United States.
The debates were a major turning point in Kennedy's race for the presidency.
We had flown after the debate to a small town in Ohio. As we started to drive, all of a sudden there was a different atmosphere. People were saying, "Guy, you got him last night. Keep after him. Go." It was obvious we'd scored in that debate. I mean, it was a very, very important part of winning the campaign.
On election night, the Kennedy force has gathered at the compound in Hyannis. It was not until the next day that the results were final. John F. Kennedy was the next president of the United States.
The question is, to what extent was it just ambition, or did he hope to attain major goals, whether he could master the American government and put through the programs he had promised in his campaign. And I don't think Kennedy had spent much time worrying about whether he could put those programs through. He had spent his time worrying about getting elected. And the big test of his character and his commitment would come.
Yeah.
promise was as spectacular as the day. John F. Kennedy, with his wife Jacqueline, came into office with the highest style and grandest ambition, promising to explore the stars, conquer the deserts, eradicate disease, to heed the command of Isaiah and let the oppressed go free. His sense of optimism and ambition seemed unlimited.
All this will not be finished in the first 100 days, nor will it be finished in the first 1,000 days, nor in the life of this administration. From this time and place, to friend and foe alike, that the torch has been passed to a new generation of Americans.
John F. Kennedy's campaign aroused expectations of a bold, activist president. But in the first half of his presidency, his attention would be absorbed in crisis abroad. The expectations of strong leadership at home were met with caution and stalemate. The majority of the country was not pressing him for social change. Kennedy sees the public's imagination, a symbol of their aspirations for money, power, glamour. He came to office in the final years of an era of contentment. Young Americans had conservative attitudes, narrow horizons. They were called the silent generation. For most of America, the feverish consumption of the good life obscured the need for change.
Get all that garbage out tonight, or you don't go out Friday night. Jaggedy-yak.
But there was another America. Segregated by law and attitude, deprived of the most elementary promise of equal opportunity, were demanding change. To them, the Kennedy rhetoric gave new hope. That new hope stirred old and deep divisions, the majority complacent and indifferent to change. Blacks demanding it, a small white minority prepared to use violence to stop it. The challenge to unite a fragmented country and Kennedy's hesitant response were to haunt his presidency. For a time, the dazzling style of the new president distracted the country from its divisions. It was as if America had elected not only a president, but a king and queen. He was young and handsome. She spoke French and wore designer clothes. Kennedy ushered in a new political era where appearance seemed to mean as much as performance.
In every sense of the word, they were a glamorous couple. Pictures of the president sailing or playing with his children. And that had never happened before. You'd never seen that before.
To bring you the first of President John F. Kennedy's news conferences. This is being presented live for the first time.
He was the first president to adopt television as a persuasive arm of his office, the last to seduce the press.
It's been a long time since we've had a definitive report on your health. How is your aching back?
It depends on the weather, political and otherwise.
The image of Kennedy portrayed by reporters was heroic, intelligent, powerful, exaggerated. In fact, Kennedy had more style than power. He held neither government nor Congress in the palm of his hand.
Kennedy accumulated tremendous personal popularity. The trouble is, popularity is not power. Power is the ability to move other people in government who may feel very differently from you. And I don't think that Kennedy ever found the secret of translating his personal popularity into fundamental legislative power or administrative power.
Our national household is cluttered with unfinished and neglected tasks. Our cities are being engulfed in squalor.
Kennedy put before Congress most of the programs on the Democratic liberal agenda with one stark omission, a civil rights bill. But his promise of justice was fueling expectations, building into a national crisis that would prove the most severe test of his domestic presidency.
The beautiful rhetoric of his campaign and of his early presidency inspired people and served as a catalyst for much of the action. Blacks all over the country, especially young blacks, said, I want to get the country moving too.
Farmer and other activists began what would become known as the Freedom Rides. They rode buses through the South, blacks in the front of the bus, whites in the back, in open defiance of Southern segregation. With this blunt and dramatic gesture, they aimed to foment a crisis that would force federal intervention.
I'm a taking a ride on the Greyhound bus line. I'm a riding the front seat to Jackson this time. Hallelujah, I'm a traveling.
Hallelujah, 85. Hallelujah, I'm a traveling down Green on Main Line.
The Freedom Riders rode into a storm of violence, their bus burned by angry whites. Taunted and beaten by mobs. As they moved deeper into the South, the violence grew worse. President Kennedy gave federal protection to the besieged Freedom Riders, but he saw their protest as unnecessary, a political embarrassment.
It was embarrassing the country. It was embarrassing the administration. But you see, that was precisely the reason for it. We had to bring about that kind of embarrassment to compel them to act.
Kennedy made symbolic changes at the White House, appointing blacks to important posts. His brother, the Attorney General, mobilized the Justice Department, sending a wave of lawyers south to enforce existing law.
We were considerably more active than previous administrations, more energetic, more directed. We brought in lots more lawsuits. We moved around in the South much more. We made people much madder.
It was not enough. Kennedy had promised legislative, executive, and moral leadership in civil rights. Black leaders pressed him for action, but Kennedy would not stand and fight for racial justice. He feared losing the political battle that would follow. Promises notwithstanding, he would only propose legislation if he knew he had the votes.
When I feel that there's necessity for a congressional action, with a chance of getting that congressional action, then I will recommend it to the Congress.
I would have had him go to the American people and say, I am not at all sure that such a bill will pass, but it ought to pass, and I ought to give the American people the opportunity to debate it, and I hope that you will pass it.
Kennedy did not believe in failure, knowing that the crucial moral issue of that time, the issue that was beginning to boil up in American politics and American life, was civil rights. I think we can say that perhaps he miscalculated the central nature of that issue.
Kennedy had other congressional priorities, but there were few dramatic reforms. Kennedy's margin was narrow, his Congress recalcitrant. Control by a coalition of Republicans and Southern Democrats opposed to change. Many of his major bills went down to defeat.
He wouldn't do what Lyndon Johnson would do, is have these endless breakfasts with him and lick him like a St. Bernard the way Johnson did. Jack would have him down to the movies or something like that.
Kennedy was not as effective a leader of Congress as Johnson would prove to be. He was cautious and not interested in the detail of legislative trading and bartering.
While Kennedy coped with an unyielding Congress, a troubling unemployment in the nation persisted. His advisors urged him to present new legislation to attack it. The idea was daring. A tax cut to encourage consumer spending, which would commit the country for the first time to a deficit, to a public debt. Again, he hesitated, thinking Congress not ready. Halfway through his presidency, the new frontier remained unconquered. Kennedy's achievement had yet to match his rhetoric. There had been little real change for black Americans. Many began to question Kennedy's promise, to doubt his moral leadership.
Martin Luther King said, "I believed and hoped that John Kennedy would have the understanding, the intelligence, the ability, and the moral commitment and fervor to do what we've needed to have a president do in civil rights. I now know that he has the basic understanding of the problem, the intelligence, the ability, but I'm not sure. I think the moral fervor I'd hoped for is missing."
The black struggle for equality would soon compel the president to make civil rights a national priority. But for a time, foreign crises would consume most of his attention.
The President of the United States.
John F. Kennedy saw himself elected not only as President of the United States, but as Commander-in-Chief of the free world.
"We shall bear any burden, support any friend."
To an America that felt in danger of becoming a second-rate power, Kennedy promised to reverse the tide of communism.
"Oppose any foe to assure the survival and the success of liberty."
Now his performance as a world leader must match the promise. The challenges were far flung. In the space race, the Soviets were far ahead, putting a man in orbit for the first time. Kennedy's space program would eventually overtake the Russians, but other challenges demanded immediate action. Communist insurgents were making gains in Laos. The Congo Civil War was perceived as a communist target of opportunity. Since the end of World War II, the Soviet Union and the West had been at loggerheads over Berlin. Khrushchev was growing belligerent. And just 90 miles from home, Fidel Castro was developing an alliance with the Soviets. On both sides of the Iron Curtain, the chill deepened. There was a growing sense of confrontation.
They still considered at that time that there is only one enemy for the United States, the Soviet Union, and they had to deal with the Soviet Union with a tough line.
Kennedy in January 1961, it's a young, bold militarist, one would say, you see, who thinks that the world is before him and he could conquer it, and only, you see, you pump power and nothing else.
Belief in American power was central to the world perspective shared by Kennedy and his staff. Brilliant men of supreme self-confidence. Secretary of Defense Robert McNamara, National Security Advisor McGeorge Bundy from Harvard, his deputy Walt Rostow from MIT.
They all had, a very sharp and high IQ, but I think the other common characteristic was a slight arrogant tone, a conviction that the world was really divided into two categories, those who know and those who don't. And they surely were among those who knew.
They were filled with a kind of, I'm an egghead, but I'm tough, macho style. This was the American century, and they were going to be the assistants to the new emperor, and they could handle the world.
Cuba was an early target. Castro had to be removed. The scheme, conceived under Eisenhower, called for these disaffected Cuban exiles to generate an internal uprising against Castro. For 8 months, they were trained in Guatemala by the CIA. They would be landed at the Bay of Pigs. In the Oval Office, a debate. Would the plan work? Could it remain secret? The CIA reassured the new president.
What did you say?
Kennedy now emerged as commander of U.S. covert operations.
Well, first I want to say that there will not be under any conditions an intervention in Cuba by United States Armed Forces.
At a critical meeting on the Cuban invasion, the president polled his staff. No one voted against the invasion. The operation was approved, a decision rooted in the strident anti-communism of the time.
Right next door is the nation we freed in 1898, Cuba. A communist tyranny holds sway, and whiskers do not hide the naked face of dictatorship.
All I can say is we were all paranoid then about Cuba, and this nation is still paranoid about Cuba. And I think it is a very, very serious problem today, as it certainly was then. In a very real sense, we were captives of that paranoia.
April 17th, 1,400 men were landed at the Bay of Pigs. Castro's forces were ready. In 2 days, the brigade was crushed. The CIA had grossly miscalculated anti-Castro support in Cuba. Immediately, the world press revealed that the invasion had been carried off with U.S. ships, supported by U.S. planes. For Kennedy, the operation was a miserable failure. 114 men died, almost 1,200 were captured. Overconfidence, domestic political considerations, led to the invasion that tarnished the image of the new frontier, putting the new president on the defensive. Shaken and humiliated, Kennedy took responsibility.
There's an old saying that victory has 100 fathers and defeat is an orphan. And I wouldn't be surprised if information is poured into you in regard to...
Oh, it was an inexperienced, immature, ignorant administration that proceeded with a plan that it inherited, but which it didn't have to proceed with.
The Bay of Pigs and its outcome may well have had a very serious effect on Soviet assessment of Kennedy. They thought he was young, brash, untried, and wobbly. Wobbly and could be pushed around.
I do not believe that such a discussion would benefit us during the present difficult situation.
Castro was still in power. Kennedy immediately shook up the CIA and repeated his demands that the agency get rid of Castro. The president perceived a growing danger that the Latin American Third World would fall to communist ideology.
He countered by stressing positive programs, epitomizing a generous and caring America. Volunteers in his imaginative Peace Corps spread worldwide to attack hunger and illiteracy. In Latin America, Kennedy's Alliance for Progress offered cash support to poor nations.
But Castro haunted him. U.S. government cash was increasingly used to prop up repressive regimes supporting Kennedy's anti-Castro stance. The CIA hatched assassination plots against the Cuban leader. And Castro was driven even more firmly into the Soviet camp.
Just weeks after the Bay of Pigs, before the president regained his balance, Khrushchev accepted Kennedy's earlier invitation to a summit meeting.
The fact that the president had, in a sense, fallen flat on his face in the Bay of Pigs made it even more necessary to take a very tough line towards the Soviets. And I think this showed in the Berlin crisis in the summer of 1961.
The standoff in Berlin dominated the agenda when Kennedy met Khrushchev at their summit conference in Vienna. Khrushchev threatened war. The scene of a confrontation between John F. Kennedy and Nikita Khrushchev that seemed for a moment to threaten World War III. The military decisions made by Kennedy at the time of that crisis would shape U.S. military strategy for years to come. They would also trigger a nuclear arms race that would later grow to tragic dimensions. The Second World War had left Berlin isolated deep in communist East Germany. The city itself was divided, half communist, half free. The U.S. and its allies controlled the western sector, the Soviets the eastern one. The crisis began in the early summer when there was still an open border. First a trickle, then a stream, then a flood of people chose to flee the communist East, to choose the freedom and prosperity of the western sector. In the Kremlin, Khrushchev chafed beneath the daily humiliation inflicted by thousands deserting communism. He determined to stop the exodus by sealing off Berlin. He would force the Allies to recognize East Germany as a separate state and thus complete his grand design to divide forever Russia's historic enemy, Germany. In this atmosphere, Kennedy met Khrushchev in Vienna. Both men were on the defensive. Kennedy because of Cuba, Khrushchev because of Berlin. Both men talked tough.
Khrushchev set out to try to intimidate this new young president of the United States with an ultimatum on Berlin. And he did so in very harsh terms. At one point he said, "Now this is what we're going to do. And if there's interference from the West, there will be war."
I made it clear to Mr. Khrushchev that the security of Western Europe, and therefore our own security, are deeply involved in our presence and our access rights to West Berlin, and that we are determined to maintain those rights at any risk.
On Soviet television, Khrushchev responded. With increased belligerency, he threatened again to seal off West Berlin. War, nuclear war, now seemed a possibility. And many believed Kennedy's oft-repeated campaign charges that Russia held a huge lead in nuclear missiles. By the time the Berlin crisis broke, Kennedy had received new and startling information.
There was a missile gap, but the gap was between our forces and the Soviet forces, with us having a greatly superior force.
In fact, to counter America's more than 40 ICBMs, Russia had no more than 7.
The generous estimate, in other words, was said we found 6 or 7 missiles we could look at when we were looking for hundreds.
But that news was countered by a revelation recently made public. The Pentagon's only nuclear battle plan called for such devastation that America's massive nuclear advantage was virtually useless.
The only plan the United States had for the use of strategic weapons was a massive, total, comprehensive, obliterating strategic attack upon the Soviet Union.
But essentially it provided for shooting the works, not for selective targeting.
It was not only an attack on the Soviet Union, as I recollect it, it involved an attack on the Warsaw Pact countries and Red China. And there was no provision for separating them out. It would be an attack on everything red.
The plan called for the simultaneous launching of more than 3,400 nuclear warheads aimed at the entire communist bloc. Projected toll, 300 million dead. As the details were laid before him, Kennedy was shocked and angered.
I saw the president get a very irritated and impatient look, and he made a gesture which I later saw quite a few times. I don't have the nice white teeth he had, but he'd go like that. And it showed, you know, I can't stand this.
He asked me to go back to the Oval Office with him afterwards for something, and as we went through the door, with a very strange little look on his face, he said, "And we call ourselves the human race."
For the sake of Berlin, neither Kennedy nor Khrushchev was prepared to risk nuclear war. But at the same time, backing down was a political impossibility for Kennedy. He had to appear ready for nuclear war. And in a harsh maneuver, he set off in the American people panicky preparations for a catastrophe that was unlikely to occur.
In the event of an attack, the lives of those families which are not hit in a nuclear blast and fire can still be saved if they can be warned to take shelter and if that shelter is available.
Americans were forced to confront and prepare for the unthinkable.
If I die, let me die with my head held high.
The nature of the attack would provide little, if any, warning for evacuation.
A fallout shelter in your basement.
The room is designed with an atomic war in mind.
Without shelter, millions would face death.
They're learning to live, they are learning to die.
The time to start is now.
In my footsteps, before I go down under the ground.
As Americans dug in for the nuclear holocaust, the Kremlin watched the situation in East Berlin slip further from its control.
And Saturday, there was the biggest flood of refugees in years. About 4,000 in one day.
Dawn, August 13th. The communists had begun sealing off the eastern sector of Berlin. Overnight, the city had been severed. On one side, the free world. On the other, a population trapped behind bricks and barbed wire. Days later, Kennedy ordered an American convoy to drive across communist East Germany to test Allied access rights to West Berlin. Many believed this small force could touch off World War III. But the Soviets allowed the convoy to enter the city. Kennedy had kept his pledge to keep West Berlin free. But the confrontation over Berlin would affect U.S. military strategy for two decades. Kennedy and McNamara determined to move away from heavy dependence on nuclear weapons. They began to develop a more credible war plan that became the foundation of modern nuclear strategy. They also instituted civilian control over nuclear weapons and stricter measures to prevent nuclear war by accident.
At McNamara, age was the blooming of American nuclear strategy, American nuclear thinking. But since that time, no American Secretary of Defense provided anything more to the American nuclear strategy. It still made it.
In the months after the Berlin confrontation, Kennedy made another major move to increase America's massive nuclear superiority. But that action would have tragic implications for the world's future. Despite his growing understanding of the nuclear danger, despite America's 10-to-1 advantage in intercontinental ballistic missiles, and a yet greater advantage in nuclear-equipped bombers and submarines, Kennedy proceeded to order 1,000 more ICBMs. Each carried a warhead 80 times more powerful than the Hiroshima bomb. That action inadvertently triggered what has become the greatest arms race in history. Strategically, the decision was unnecessary. It was prompted by domestic, political, and military pressure. The Air Force wanted 3,000 missiles. White House aide Kazin recommended 600. Kennedy brokered the difference and settled for 1,000 as the lowest number politically acceptable.
He was cautious. He was not rash. And to have said, I was all wrong. None of this is true. The Air Force doesn't know what it's talking about. We don't need these missiles. That would have been a very venturesome thing to do, and he clearly wasn't about to do it.
To the Russians, Kennedy's escalation of America's already overpowering missile strength suggested a terrifying prospect, that the U.S. was preparing for a first strike that could obliterate their forces and any hope of retaliation with a single blow.
I would say yes. There were such a view that the United States is starting preparation or thinking about this, particularly after this decision, as you mentioned before, about 1,000 missiles and some statements about counterforce strategy. So the answer is yes.
Their response was to accelerate the buildup of their own strategic nuclear forces. I think this explains a considerable part of the buildup of their forces during the 1960s and 1970s. It is a perfect example of the action-reaction phenomenon that leads to an arms race. I strongly believe that today the Soviets would have fewer strategic warheads than they do had we behaved differently in the 1960s than we did.
It was the first and the beginning of accelerating the arms race in a strategic field. And maybe many things wouldn't happen today if there wouldn't be the idea of building 1,000 missiles.
I think it was ultimately disastrous because we taught the Soviets a lesson, which was that they have to match whatever we do. And indeed they did.
It is one of the tragic ambiguities of the Kennedy presidency. The man who fought hard to bring nuclear weapons under control was the same man who set in motion the most dangerous arms race in history. Now, he would also have to deal with demands at home that were building toward violent revolution. In the South, a revolution was building, exploding in racial hatred. Kennedy, hesitant at first, would finally rise to meet the crisis in civil rights, the preeminent national issue of his time. As Kennedy moved into the last half of his presidency, segregation in the South remained essentially intact. Blacks were still banned from white schools and public accommodations, still denied the right to vote. Many who tried feared for their lives. Kennedy, still popular in the South, had not yet attacked the heart of segregation. Then, in the fall of 1962, came a turning point. Inspired by Kennedy's inaugural speech, James Meredith applied to the all-white University of Mississippi. He was rejected. A federal court ordered his admission. He tried four times to physically enter the campus. Four times he was turned back. The stage was set for a showdown. Mississippi was the most segregated state in the Union, and Governor Ross Barnett intended to keep it that way.
Oxford town around the bend, come to the door, he couldn't get in, all because of the color of his skin. What do you think about that, my friend? He went down to Oxford town, guns and clubs followed him down, all because his face was brown. Better get away from Oxford town.
On Sunday afternoon, when the campus was quiet, U.S. Marshals smuggled Meredith into the university. Inevitably, word got out and a mob began to form. Kennedy went on television to talk about the crisis.
If this country should ever reach the point where any man or group of men, by force or threat of force, could long deny the commands of our court and our Constitution, then no law would stand free from doubt.
Even as he spoke, the mob in Oxford rioted. By midnight, two people were dead, 166 wounded. Kennedy ordered in the army. It was the open break with the South he had hoped to avoid.
At Oxford, President Kennedy had to break the rules so that govern federal-state relations. He knew the resistance would have to be overcome, that otherwise his presidency would be a failure, and that that moment in history was right for doing that, but that it was going to be very, very difficult and very, very costly to him personally.
Oxford town in the afternoon, everybody singing a soft tune. Two men died neath the Mississippi moon, somebody better investigate soon.
Kennedy's actions at Oxford made it clear to the South that local authorities could no longer thwart the law, but he had been forced to act.
I got the impression that he was frustrated by the intractability of Barnett more than the injustice of what was going on. I mean, he understood that intellectually, how much he felt it in his guts and how much he bled for it and how much he cried over it, I don't know.
It was not something that Kennedy sought. He didn't really try to break the barriers. He let the tide move him along. And I don't think he asserted the kind of presidential leadership that people expected of him who had voted for him.
Although Kennedy was still hesitant in the battle for civil rights, he was becoming increasingly aware of the extent of poverty in America. When he finally proposed his innovative tax cut, he expressed particular concern for the jobless.
We are talking about helping people. People who've been looking for work for a long time in eastern Kentucky, in West Virginia, and Pennsylvania.
Kennedy planned a war on poverty for 1964.
Oh, he that gets hurt will be he who has stalled. The battle outside raging will soon shake your windows and rattle your walls. Oh, the times, they are a-changing.
By 1963, the silent generation, aroused by television images of poverty and racism, began to listen to the voices of protest. In the spring of 1963, the country would be shaken out of its indifference. America's racial strife was about to erupt with such violence that Kennedy could no longer lead from behind. The trouble began in Birmingham.
Birmingham was a city that had not given an inch on integration, not in schools, not in employment. So we decided that we would go to Birmingham.
Now I'm tired of segregation, and now I want my equal rights to well respected and
Black leaders began a boycott in Birmingham. Blacks from all over the country joined them. Bull Connor, the city's chief of police, confronted the demonstrators. Thousands were arrested. Despite the arrest, the protest continued. The confrontation, brought into the living room by television, escalated into a brutal orgy of violence. Stunned the nation and resounded in the Oval Office.
Crisis and conflict brought out the best of him in many cases. And this particular crisis, I think, moved him toward putting civil rights at the top of his priorities.
The spring of 1963 saw 14,000 arrests in hundreds of demonstrations. The country's bitter divisions were bared. Kennedy finally made the commitment civil rights leaders had waited for. For the first time, a president told the nation change was a moral necessity.
The fires of frustration and discord are burning in every city, north and south, where legal remedies are not at hand. Redress is sought in the streets, in demonstrations, parades, and protests, which create tension and threaten violence and threaten lives. We are confronted primarily with a moral issue. It is as old as the scriptures and is as clear as the American Constitution.
Kennedy finally asked Congress for legislation. It was a major step forward in the federal effort to end all segregation by law.
A great change is at hand, and our task, our obligation, is to make that revolution, that change, peaceful and constructive for all.
I think he became probably the first American president to say that the question of race, the question of civil rights, the question of the American Negro is really a moral issue.
We really felt that the promise of America to all her citizens was going to be fulfilled.
But in the South, Kennedy was a pariah. Angry resistance to his administration grew. On Capitol Hill, the debate brought Kennedy's entire legislative program to a halt.
I have charged here today that there are communist influences in the integration movement.
We have no evidence that any of the leaders of the civil rights movements in the United States are communists.
While Kennedy publicly defended civil rights leaders, privately he acquiesced in a secret FBI investigation of Martin Luther King. J. Edgar Hoover claimed King was influenced by a communist advisor. Kennedy was too politically cautious to challenge Hoover. If Hoover leaked his allegations about King, Kennedy feared it would sink his embattled civil rights bill.
The march will be held on August the 28th.
By now, Kennedy was worried not only about King's friends, but about his plan to march on Washington. Kennedy was afraid it would further antagonize Congress. But King pressed on with the march. Kennedy finally lent quiet support to the march, but declined to take part. It was the largest peaceful demonstration in the history of the United States.
I have a dream. My four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today.
King's speech electrified the country, making him the unquestioned leader of the movement.
When all of God's children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual, free at last, free at last, thank God Almighty, we are free at last.
But King still had trouble with the White House. Shortly after the march, Robert Kennedy approved an FBI tap on King's phone. Hoover had produced no direct evidence of communist influence, but the Kennedys acted on his continuing suspicions. Despite the wiretap, by now Kennedy was committed to progress in civil rights. It had become the major challenge to his domestic leadership. But it was a challenge he came to slowly. In the end, it was not John Kennedy who led the country on civil rights, but the movement which led him.
He ought to get lots of credit for having seen the necessity to, get off the dime and move, and where and about when. I don't think he could get or would have claimed credit for being the beacon. Other people were the beacon. Martin Luther King was the beacon.
The black community got out and created the movement, this sense of coming together, and President Kennedy tried to respond. And I think at time he was saying, there go my people, let me catch up with them.
September, Kennedy made one of his last trips around the country. He predicted the Civil Rights Bill would pass in 1964, as well as the tax bill and many of his social programs. The country was poised on the edge of change, and Kennedy, too, had traveled far in his short presidency.
We preach freedom around the world, and we mean it. But are we to say to the world that this is a land of the free, except for the Negroes?
Our most basic common link is that we all inhabit this small planet. We all breathe the same air. We all cherish our children's future, and we are all mortal. When power leads man towards arrogance, poetry reminds him of his limitations.
At home, Kennedy's record was marked first by hesitancy and inaction, then redeemed by courage and perception. He came to office reluctant to risk political capital in the causes he had championed during his campaign. There was blood on the streets before he acknowledged racial justice as a moral necessity. But he grew. At the end, he was leading the nation towards resolution of the great divisive issue of his time. In foreign affairs, his record was equally uneven. While seeking to lead the world away from Armageddon, he would, at the same time, commit his nation to a distant, bitter war. Vietnam, a small Asian country half a world away. To combat communist aggression there, Kennedy made the first major American commitment to war in Vietnam, expanding a token force to an army of 16,000 men. He launched America into a war that succeeding presidents would expand to vast dimensions. A dirty and corrosive war that would divide the United States for years to come. At first, Kennedy was preoccupied with more urgent crises: civil rights, Cuba, Berlin. Vietnam seemed a remote concern. But the Vietnamese communists, under Ho Chi Minh, had already driven the French colonial government from Vietnam, leading in 1954 to a divided country, the communist North and the American-supported South, led by Ngo Dinh Diem. Now, despite U.S. military aid, the communists were threatening Diem. Guerrillas from the North joined rebels in the South against him. He was repressive and unpopular. Khrushchev had promised to support wars of liberation. Communist China on Vietnam's border was also committed to revolution. There were concerns that both powers were fomenting guerrilla warfare in the South.
How we fight that kind of a problem, which is going to be with us all through this decade, seems to me to be one of the great problems now before the United States.
To halt the communists, Kennedy enthusiastically committed the United States to anti-guerrilla warfare.
At Fort Bragg, North Carolina, a new kind of soldier has emerged, the Special Forces Trooper, the man whose specialty is guerrilla fighting. He is distinguished by the green beret he wears.
This is another type of warfare. New in its intensity, ancient in its origin, war by guerrillas, subversives, insurgents, assassins, war by ambush instead of by combat.
In May 1961, Kennedy had secretly dispatched 500 men to assist the troubled Diem regime. 400 were green berets. The number of Americans was small, but the move was momentous. Kennedy had knowingly breached the troop limits set by international agreement. He had acted for political and strategic reasons. No democratic president could risk appearing soft on communism in Asia because of the communist takeover of China during Truman's presidency. In the civil war in Laos, Kennedy had felt impelled, largely for military reasons, to negotiate a settlement between the communists and the Laotian government. Now, in the Cold War climate of the day, he felt forced to take a stand in Vietnam.
At the time that he decided that we would not put troops into Laos, he said that if we had to make a fight for Southeast Asia, it would have to be in Vietnam.
The fight was near at hand. After 6 months in Vietnam, the 400 Green Berets had made little difference. The Diem government was still in peril.
With this situation in mind, I've asked General Taylor to go to Saigon this week, discuss ways in which we can perhaps better assist the government of Vietnam in meeting this threat to its independence.
That mission of General Maxwell Taylor and White House aide Walt Rostow was historic. After 8 days in Vietnam, they returned with a critical recommendation. 6,000 to 8,000 combat troops were needed.
Up, two, three, four, marching down the street. Rolling of the drums and the tramping of the feet. General salutes and the mothers waving we. Here comes the big parade. Don't be afraid. Price is paid. One more parade.
In November, after considerable debate, Kennedy authorized the 8,000 troops. They were to be advisors, not combat troops, instructed to shoot only if shot at. He also sent equipment and warplanes and helicopters with American crews. Kennedy's decision was the first crucial step toward American military commitment in the Vietnam War.
So young, so strong, so ready for the war, so willing to go and die upon a foreign shore. All march together, everybody looks the same. So there is no one you can blame. Don't be ashamed. Light the flame. One more parade.
This is the beginning of escalation. The 8,000 of advisors are a big step of escalation. Everything you see is important is the beginning. And the beginning always a very small one.
President Kennedy expanded the commitment of the United States to Vietnam without knowing he was doing it. He put forces in, little forces in, first. In the eyes of the people who were there, the United States was going to help support, was going to support them actively.
Did your mission represent something of a turning point in terms of the U.S. involvement in Vietnam?
I think that's a fair statement. Obviously, no one anticipated where we were going.
In the next year and a half, Kennedy's buildup would continue. By the end of 1962, there would be 11,000 American troops in Vietnam.
The spear point of aggression has been blunted in South Vietnam.
It was a far cry from the Kennedy of the mid-50s. Then, in Congress, he'd been an eloquent spokesman against great power involvement in emerging countries. Now, as president, he had a changed perspective, one that led him to disregard his old concerns and the advice of his closest allies.
General de Gaulle tried to warn him about getting involved in Vietnam too much, but he didn't take it too seriously, because he was sure of American superiority in terms of arms and power, and he didn't believe that America couldn't win.
But Kennedy and his advisors failed to see the Vietnamese nationalist determination to drive out all foreigners forever. Instead, they viewed the confrontation as part of the strategic East-West struggle.
What that completely neglected was the local origins of the war in Vietnamese history. After all, this was the one place where the nationalist mystique had been for years and years largely captured by the communists. We decided to treat it as a part of the world struggle between the expansionist communist powers and ourselves.
Moreover, Kennedy and the men around him overestimated their own knowledge and understanding of Vietnam.
We didn't even know the nature of the problem. We didn't know the culture, the history, the psychology of the South Vietnamese and the other Indochinese.
The policy makers in Kennedy time. They never raise the question whether to intervene. They raise only the question how to intervene.
By the summer of 1963, the Diem regime and the American commitment to it were unraveling. Students joined the Buddhists in open rebellion. Buddhist monks protested repression by burning themselves to death. The communists were gaining. Diem declared martial law.
Of course, this led to the eventual American support for the forces working for a change of government and to the coup that overthrew Diem and to his death.
In late August, the State Department cabled Ambassador Henry Cabot Lodge in Saigon. He was told to inform the South Vietnamese generals plotting a coup that the United States would directly support them if they were successful. Asked if the Diem government could regain support, Kennedy hinted at things to come.
With changes in policy and perhaps with in personnel, I think it can. If it doesn't make those changes, I would think that the chances of winning it would not be very good.
2 months after the American signal of support, the Vietnamese generals acted, overthrowing the Diem government, murdering Diem and his brother, secret police chief Ngo Dinh Nu. But in Saigon, Ambassador Lodge was pleased with the coup's success.
He was very glad. He said in French. I say it in French.
Sure.
It's merveilleux.
Which means?
Marvelous. And congratulations.
American complicity in the overthrow of Diem deepened American involvement. There were now 16,000 American troops in Vietnam, increasingly engaged in combat. America, under the leadership of John F. Kennedy, had entered the Vietnam War.
The decision to send more advisors was a determinative decision. I don't think there's a turning back. We do not know how to maneuver hairpin turns in foreign policy, and a course was set.
In the short period of the Kennedy administration, it's clear that the American involvement went much, much deeper than before, and that, in a sense, it was put on rails in that period.
120 Americans died in 1,000 days. The numbers were small, but their significance was not. They were an omen of casualties to come.
Each time an advisor was killed, you are planted in that much deeper. That many more Americans were bound to be killed, and each American killed becomes a rationale for putting more in because we can't let down those who have already died.
It is another tragic paradox. The man who warmed to the Third World struggles for independence led the United States into the Vietnam War. He lived long enough to begin to see the risks that war posed, but not long enough to choose between deeper commitment or withdrawal. In the last year of Kennedy's life, he was haunted by the fear of nuclear war. Kennedy once again felt the chill of a pending confrontation with Nikita Khrushchev. A confrontation that would be far more serious than Berlin. The Cuban Missile Crisis was a turning point for John F. Kennedy. He would be the first president to lead his country towards coexistence with the Soviets. The first to make the search for peace in the nuclear age a primary concern. It began in the fall of 62. In September, most Americans were only dimly aware the country was moving towards another crisis. The Soviets were pouring massive amounts of unidentified weapons into Cuba. The CIA reported rumors that the weapons might include ballistic missiles. On the very morning Kennedy greeted this choir from Arkansas, he sent a message to the Soviets that the gravest issues would arise if the Russians provided Castro with offensive weapons. Several weeks later, the CIA informed the president that in spite of his warnings, the Soviets had deceived him. They were installing nuclear missiles in Cuba. Faced with CIA predictions that the missiles could be operational within days, military advisors demanded swift action.
This seemed to the military to be a heaven-sent occasion to wipe out the Castro regime once and for all by massive strikes. As General LeMay used to like to say, bomb them back to the Stone Age.
Repeatedly throughout the crisis, the president would be urged to destroy the Cuban missile sites. Now, for the second time in just over a year, he was forced to prepare for war. He ordered the mobilization of invasion forces. Nuclear units were placed on alert. To avoid an attack on Cuba, the president instead imposed a quarantine to stop further delivery of Soviet weapons. But he also made it very clear that if the missiles were not removed, it could mean war.
I call upon Chairman Khrushchev to halt and eliminate this clandestine, reckless, and provocative threat to world peace.
For the American people, with Soviet missiles being installed 90 miles away, with Soviet ships steaming towards Cuba, with Soviet subs prowling the Atlantic, nuclear war seemed a very real possibility. In the White House, concern focused on miscalculation.
Certainly, President Kennedy had no intention of initiating the use of nuclear weapons. I think it's highly unlikely that Khrushchev would have authorized use of nuclear weapons, but that wasn't the danger. The danger was a danger of miscalculation, of loss of control. Then this is a danger of all war, that you bungle into these damn situations.
Kennedy now believed the chances of war were 1 out of 3.
Saturday, October 27th, was the worst day of the crisis. All the news that came in during that day was bad. News that the Soviets were continuing work on the missile sites despite our warnings. News that the Soviet ships were now steaming once again toward the quarantine barrier. And by this time, we were all exhausted. Tempers were beginning to rise. Vice President Johnson said, "When I was a boy in Texas, and we walked along the road, and a rattlesnake came up and threatened us, there was only one answer, and that was to take a stick and crush it."
A deeply troubled president again resisted the demand to invade Cuba. The Soviets sent a number of messages, not all consistent. But the president gambled that the Soviets did not want war, and he sent his brother to the Soviet embassy with an ultimatum. In exchange for Kennedy's pledge not to invade Cuba, Khrushchev would withdraw the missiles, or the United States would be forced to take them out.
And I recall, on a Saturday night, I think the date was October 27th, being uncertain, and this sounds melodramatic, but it's exactly the way I thought, and I wasn't the only one that thought it, being uncertain whether I'd ever see another Saturday night.
The following morning, October 28th, an urgent message transmitted by Radio Moscow.
Premier Khrushchev has sent a message to President Kennedy today. The Soviet government has ordered the dismantling of weapons in Cuba, as well as their crating and return to the Soviet Union.
The crisis was over. In Moscow, Khrushchev resisted the Soviet hardliners who felt humiliated and would later further escalate the nuclear arms race. For Kennedy, it was a decisive moment.
After the missile crisis, I think Kennedy began to have more sympathy with
Khrushchev and began to see Khrushchev almost as a partner. I think he felt that both of them, having stared down the nuclear abyss during the missile crisis, had a chance now to move away from that.
Because it was, I think, both sides came to a conclusion that it was very dangerous.
What we hope to do is lessen the chance of a military collision between these two great nuclear powers, which together have the power to kill 300 million people in the short space of a day.
By mid-1963, Kennedy was persuaded that the need for coexistence was the greatest issue of our time. Having taken a tough stand with the Soviets on Berlin and on the Cuban missiles, he now felt free to shrug off the hardline pressures that had influenced him in the past. Now he took the lead in rallying support for nuclear arms control. The search for peace had become the central issue of his presidency.
What kind of a peace do I mean, and what kind of a peace do we seek? Not a Pax Americana, enforced on the world by American weapons of war. Not the peace of the grave, or the security of the slave. Not merely peace for Americans, but peace for all men and women. Not merely peace in our time, but peace in all time.
Not Pax Americana, but peace for all the people, for not only for American people, but for the people of the world. You know, I could recite that by heart, you see, if only in Russian, you see. But of course, it's tremendous difference, tremendous difference.
Let us re-examine our attitude towards the Cold War, remembering we're not engaged in a debate.
And Kennedy in June 1963, it's a wise man. It's really a statesman with a big S, you know.
In August 1963, over opposition in both the United States and the Soviet Union, the first arms control treaty was signed. It was a limited treaty that banned the testing of nuclear weapons in the atmosphere and underwater. But there was genuine optimism that Kennedy's initiative would slow the escalation of nuclear weapons. The Cold War hero of the past had now committed himself to lead the world away from Armageddon. And in the summer of 63, he seemed triumphant.
Everybody liked being led by the United States at that time. They liked to have President Kennedy as the leader of the Western world. That was his major triumph.
Citizens in Berlin, and therefore, as a free man, I take pride in the words, Ich bin ein Berliner.
He had led the West through the most dangerous of times.
He passed through his 1,000 days, adding 1,000 days to the time since a nuclear weapon has been fired in anger. I suspect if you could have talked to him quietly, he would have put that very high on his list.
On the horizon, the 64 election, the promise of a second term. Kennedy had charted a course for himself and his country.
My fellow Americans, let us, if we can, step back from the shadows of war, seek out the way of peace. And if that journey is 1,000 miles, or even more, let history record that we, in this land, at this time, took the first step.
The eyes of Texas and the nation are focused on Dallas. A big city has been told to be on its good behavior today, and we're it.
his charm, and here is the President of the United States.
November 22nd. President John F. Kennedy was shot and killed here today, period. With no one attending him but physicians and nurses, he died without regaining consciousness or uttering a word. Lyndon B. Johnson was sworn in at 2:39 p.m. Central Standard Time as the 36th President of the United States. Period. Paragraph.
Had been brought back, and we had a brief mass in the west wing of the White House. And in the morning, about 7, the phone next to my bed rang, and I heard the operator say, "Mr. Salinger, the president's calling." And for a minute, it just went through my head that I just had a terrible nightmare. And then I heard this voice say, "Pierre, this is Lyndon." And that was the first time I really believed that John Kennedy was dead.
The great sense of loss at his death was in part an acknowledgement of his extraordinary growth as president. The final judgment on Kennedy's presidency may always be elusive. He left a profoundly contradictory record in foreign affairs. The shining side? Remarkable insight and courage in redefining the nature of U.S.-Soviet relations, moving away from his own campaign rhetoric to a deeper understanding of the need for coexistence. In the fashion of the greatest presidents, he seized and identified the most momentous issue of our time, the danger of nuclear war. And he seemed ready to dedicate his political future to the control of nuclear weapons. But Kennedy had also triggered the greatest arms race in history, and misperceiving the limits of American power, launched America into the Vietnam War. At home, his great legislative triumphs came after death. The historic Civil Rights Act, his bold tax cut, were both passed in 1964, in part in tribute to his memory. His demands for social change inspired a generation but did not fundamentally transform the country or its institutions. He was a transitional leader who helped lay the foundation for things to come. We judge him on his record as it is, unable to predict what he might have done. He was, in the words of the French ambassador at the time, quoting Stendhal, a brilliant maybe, a man who had not reached his own high aspirations, who was given little time to try.
What haunts us about Kennedy is that he was aspiring so high, even with his failures. And we all like to feel that we're aspiring to certain things. And just as we have had opportunities lost to us personally, he had his supreme opportunity lost to him because of his assassination. I think that's what haunts us today.
Kennedy's presidency combines with the American idea that we are an unfinished country. It was an unfinished administration, broken off suddenly with all our inability to know how the story would have ended. A Franklin Roosevelt once said that democracy is a story without an end. In that sense, the Kennedy administration merges with the very theme of American democracy.
If you wish a transcript, send $3 to Journal Graphics, Box 770, Ansonia Station, New York, New York, 10023. This has been a presentation of ABC News.